Hello, John. You could introduce yourself.
Yeah, I'm John Sanderson. I'm here in the entomology department at Cornell University, and I work on greenhouse. Until recently, I worked on greenhouse pests of green managing pests of greenhouse floral crops. However, recently, because of the expansion in things like high tunnels and the expansion in vegetable production in New York State, I now work beyond just ornamentals, but now I'm working on greenhouses and high tunnels and vegetable production in those areas. So, I should say edible crops, because it could be even beyond vegetables. It could include herbs and small fruit and things like that. Anyway, it's my pleasure to be here. Let me also say another thing about this presentation. As I just mentioned, I've spent my career working on managing insect pests on floral crops, not on vegetables. And so this is new to me. And so the presentation that I'll give you today is based on things that I'm learning about. I also been in the business long enough that I've gleaned a fair amount of information on vegetable pest management in greenhouses. But there are those, for example, Judson Reed, the extension educator in the Penyan area, who is been doing this much longer than me and is a fabulous resource. And I encourage you to make contact with him with other questions or further questions about vegetable insect and mite pest management in high tunnels. Okay, so with that introduction, the first thing I wanted to cover is pesticides, the use of pesticides in high tunnels and other kinds of protected growing environments. And first of all, as you all know, it's a violation of federal law to use a pesticide in a manner that's inconsistent with its labeling. The pesticide label is a legal document. And you should know, if you don't already, that pesticides that are labeled for non-edible flower crops often cannot be legally used on vegetables and herbs, in other words, edible crops, unless that use is allowed on the label. There may be a big difference between pesticides that are legal to use on ornamental, non-edible flower crops compared to those that can be used on vegetables or other edible crops grown in greenhouses and high tunnels. And it's now this is changing. The pesticide arsenal for edible greenhouse crops is increasing, expanding, but it's still smaller than what growers who are used to growing or using pesticides on ornamentals. There's a smaller arsenal available for greenhouse vegetables and herbs. Again, that's changing. We're seeing more products being labeled for use on edible greenhouse crops, but there are more restrictions and fewer pesticides that we can use. Now, in terms of those crops that are grown outdoors normally, but are now being looked at for growing in high tunnels or other greenhouse crops, sometimes there are pesticides that are registered for use on the outdoor crop, but can you use those same pesticides on the same crops if they're grown indoors? And my immediate answer to that question is you need to ask your local DEC inspector, because it seems as if maybe there's some variation in the way that law or laws or regulations might be enforced around the state. So you need to ask your local DEC inspector what their opinion is about using a pesticide that's labeled for use outdoors on a, let's say, tomatoes. Can you use that same pesticide indoors? And however, my understanding is that a product that is labeled for a given crop outdoors may be used on that crop indoors as long as the use indoors, in other words, in a greenhouse, is not prohibited on the label. If it says on the label not to be used in greenhouses or not to be used in indoor production or something like that, then you cannot use that that pesticide. It's explicitly forbidden. But if it doesn't say anything that prohibits use indoors, then my understanding is that you can use the same pesticide you would use on that crop outdoors. You can also use that indoors. And again, remember, it's a violation of federal law to use a pesticide in a way that isn't specified on the label. Now, the other thing related to that, about using pesticides on in closed space production or on in high tunnels or greenhouses, is that there's a new set of worker protection standards that have come out recently. And so how is enclosed space production defined? Is a high tunnel considered a greenhouse? Or is a high tunnel just basically shade over the top of an outdoor crop? You know, so what is the DEC using for their understanding of what an enclosed space production entails? And this is this paragraph I've reproduced on this slide was given to me by a cooperative extension educator who asked a regional DEC inspector for to answer this question, and that DEC inspector contacted Albany DEC and apparently received this response. And so I'll read it so we all understand how it's being interpreted as far as we know by the DEC. The new definition of enclosed space production in the Worker Protection Standard, hold on a second, makes the old Worker Protection Standard definition of greenhouse and the associated past guidance obsolete. Under the new Worker Protection Standard definition of enclosed space production, any spaces that are covered in whole or in part with non-porous covering are considered enclosed spaces and subject to the special requirements for enclosed space production. So structures such as high tunnels and or hoop houses that are enclosed on top but have ends open, or greenhouses with the sides open, or any structures that are partially covered with non-porous materials are all considered enclosed space production. So that's important for you to understand that basically the DEC is considering high tunnels the same as a greenhouse in enclosed space production. Oops, here we go again. There. Now, as far as using which pesticides are legal to use in New York State on edible greenhouse crops, I refer you to a document that Dan Gilrain compiled. Dan Gilrain is at Cooperative Extension, a fantastic entomologist at Cooperative Extension of Suffolk County. Dan is absolutely first rate, and he has put together this list of crops for greenhouse edible crops, and it's listed in the box folder, the Cornell box folder that Betsy Lamb has put together for IPM for greenhouse high tunnel vegetable production, and you can find this list there. And the reason this list is very important is because it's New York State specific. There are other lists right now floating around the internet that indicate pesticides that are labeled for use on vegetables in indoor production. However, those are not specific to New York State. New York State can be different. There are some pesticides we don't have that other places do. And so that's why this list is very important. It's specific for New York State. And so be careful when you're looking at pesticides online for pesticides that are okay to use in greenhouses or in high tunnels. Use this list rather than what's on the internet. Now, the other topic before I get into most of the talk that I wanted to go over is biological control, using good bugs to kill bad bugs. And this is an exploding interest in doing this in greenhouse ornamentals, as well as in high tunnels and in indoor food, edible greenhouse crop production. And there's some things that you need to understand, though, about using biocontrol in greenhouses. First of all, if you're using, if you're, for example, growing tomatoes and you're dependent on bumblebees for pollination, you obviously must know that bumblebees are very susceptible to pesticides, many of the pesticides. And so if you are growing a crop that's dependent on pollination, then you're probably going to be forced to use biological control. Because the pesticides would be toxic to the bumblebees or other pollinators that you may be using. Okay, so if you're using bees for pollination, you're probably going to be using biological control as well. Now, another thing important to understand about using good bugs to kill bad bugs is that it rarely is successful as a curative pest management tactic. In other words, if you have an established infestation of one of the important greenhouse pests and you need to bring that pest under control, it's too late to begin making releases of natural enemies if you already have a very established or out of control pest infestation. Rarely can these natural enemies take a high pest population and bring them down under control. What they are very good at doing, however, BCAs, in other words, biocontrol agents for BCA, they are very good at keeping a small pest infestation from increasing. That's where they really excel. What they are not good for is reducing a serious pest infestation. So that means they usually must be used preventatively. Before the pest even shows up, they need to be in the crop already. So frequently, the way that they're used on ornamentals or edible crops is you've released them before the pests even show up. And the other thing to say about biological control, and this is particularly true on ornamentals, is that we don't always expect the biocontrol agents to establish on the crop and recycle on the crop. In other words, a single release of the natural enemies at the beginning of the crop doesn't mean they're going to be there in a cycle and control pests for the rest of the crop. Usually, you're going to need to release multiple times. In fact, maybe in some cases weekly, unless you're using banker plants, which we'll talk about later. Basically, you probably will need to release these on a regular basis in order to keep the pest populations from getting out of control. To get good biocontrol, you're probably going to need multiple releases. Biological control, it's important that you are up on what the pests are doing and whether the natural enemies are being effective. And then, of course, you don't rely on any one tactic to control pests. You need to combine cultural controls, biological controls, and chemical controls at times. Sources of pests that can occur in greenhouses. First of all, I'll go over some of the pests that can overwinter in a greenhouse or a high tunnel. That's really important that you know what could be in your greenhouse before you even begin growing in the spring. And one reason I'll say it probably a couple of times in this talk is that pest control for thrips, for example, begins at the end of the previous crop so that you don't overwinter a problem, because it can happen. Certainly pests come in on incoming plant materials. If you're doing a high tunnel and you've got open sides or a lot of open spaces in the structure, of course pests can come in from outside. Neighboring alfalfa fields or whatever, and also perhaps in high tunnels it's not as important, but in some cases workers spreading pests around on their clothing, either from home or from place to place in a greenhouse. A lot of these pests are very tiny, easily picked up on clothing and spread through the greenhouse that way. So you need to be aware of that. Okay, now the pests, we're going to go through a rogues gallery now of some of the pests that occur on greenhouse crops. They can be very crop specific. Some of the pests aren't going to be found on all the different crops that can be grown in greenhouses. The ones that are common and very important to many greenhouse crops, a wide variety, include aphids, spider mites, thrips, and to some extent of whiteflies. So I'm going to go through those in detail. But before I get to those, I'll go through some of the more crop-specific ones. And again, some of these may be key pests on those crops, or maybe just occasional pests. But these are, they aren't common on all crops grown in the greenhouse or high tunnel. So grasshoppers, for example, this can be, they can be a problem on high tunnel cut flowers or other kinds of cut flowers, especially in high tunnels where the sides are open and it's really easy for grasshoppers to get in to the greenhouse. And grasshoppers are general feeders, herbivores, and they can do a lot of damage. And so they're on some crops, you need to watch out for grasshoppers. Stink bugs. Not just brown marmorated stink bug, but other kinds of stink bugs are capable of feeding on using their piercing, sucking mouth parts to puncture leaves and stems and feed from the sap, but also they can actually harm the fruit itself. And there's some tomatoes here. Judd gave me these photos of some damage caused by punctures of stink bugs on tomatoes. Plant hoppers or leaf hoppers. In this case, there's a picture of potato leaf hopper, and these actually are migratory. They come up from the southeast U.S., but they come up every year, and they can be problems on certainly potatoes grown outdoors and other crops grown outdoors. But the kind of damage that they do, you can see on the left. They kind of, as they feed, they use piercing, sucking mouth parts to puncture leaf tissue, and you can see sometimes they make these little trails so you can tell that that's leaf hopper damage. But they also are capable in some cases of transmitting viruses, and they also in some cases can cause what we call hopper burn, which looks like herbicide damage, or it's actually leaves that get burned by salivary toxins that the leaf hoppers can inject into the foliage. Caterpillars, worms, cutworms, loopers, a lot of the lepidopteran pests can occur on certain greenhouse crops. There's in this this slide, I've got a cabbage looper on the left. Judson gave me a picture of tomato fruit worm damage on a young tomato in the middle, and then cutworms on the right. All of these can be pests on certain crops in vegetable crops in high tunnels in particular. Not so much in the greenhouse, but in outdoors where things can fly in and out, these can definitely affect high tunnel crops. Flea beetles. This is another picture that Justin gave me of eggplant and flea beetles. And flea beetles scare me. I wish I knew more about controlling flea beetles, but they can really be a problem. These are little tiny beetles, and the reason they're called flea beetles is that they jump very similar to the way fleas do. They've got jumping hind legs, and they jump. But they can also really do a job on foliage and in high numbers, which they can achieve, unfortunately. And then Japanese beetles can be a problem, of course, on a lot of different crops outdoors, and they can certainly come indoors. Rosaceous plants they like to feed on, but it's even worse than that. Again, cut flowers can be really harmed by Japanese beetle feeding on the flowers themselves. Anyway, Japanese beetles are another pest that can be encountered, especially in high tunnels. And then Liriomyza, or various kinds of serpentine leaf miners, can be problems. These are probably either Liriomyza with a vegetable leaf miner, or trifoliae, the one that hits floral crops. But these are flies that the maggots actually live inside the leaf, mine inside the leaf, and they make these serpentine mines. And with enough of these, they can really kill the leaf, greatly decrease photosynthesis, and cause lots. They can do some defoliation and when they get in high numbers. And perhaps tomatoes is one of the ones crops that we might occasionally see leaf miners in. Okay, so now I want to go through, and I'm going to talk about aphids. First spider mites, then aphids. No, then spider mites, thrips, aphids, then whiteflies. That'll be the order we'll take these next ones. spider mites, two-spotted spider mite is the most common spider mite that we see in greenhouses, and it's going to be the same thing on almost all high tunnel crops as well. These are actually mites, and they are related to spiders more closely than they are to insects. If you were to count the number of legs on the larger mite in this slide, you'll see they have 8 legs, which mean not 6 like insects do. So they're more closely related to spiders, and they do cause they do make webbing, which is another similarity with spiders. Although the webbing that they make is not like a spider's web. They don't use their web for prey capture. They just use it for dispersal and a little bit of environmental protection and things like that. The damage that they can do, they have piercing, sucking mouth parts. They've got little stylets. They stick into the leaf, usually from below. They're usually on the lower surface of leaves. And as when they feed, they suck the chlorophyll out of the leaf, the cells that they're attacking. And when they suck the chlorophyll out, it leaves a little tiny yellow or whitish spot, because that green chlorophyll that was in the cell has now been removed. And if you get enough mites doing this repeatedly, you get basically a whole stippling effect on the leaf, and it can take a tremendous amount of chlorophyll out of the leaf. And eventually, as you can see in the slide at the bottom, it can begin to kill the leaf, and then you see the webbing that very high populations of spider mites will cause. Again, everywhere they walk, they're constantly producing webbing, and so if you get enough of them walking back and forth, then you get the webbing effect that you can see in the bottom slide. Translaminar miticides will be more effective against spider mites if you're going to use miticides, because the mites are large, they're very tiny, they are covered with webbing usually, and they're on the lower surface of a leaf, making coverage, pesticide coverage, very difficult to get on the lower surface of leaves. And so translaminar miticides, you can think of them as if the miticide hits the top of the leaf, it soaks through to the bottom where the mites are feeding, and you can kill them that way. So coverage is not as important if you have a miticide that has translaminar properties. Okay, when spider mite populations get really high, this is what can happen. What happens is they feed out all the chlorophyll on the leaves of a plant. They go to the highest point they can get to, and if you were to look very carefully at the mites in the top of the pile on either one of these slides, they actually have their legs up in the air, and they're wiggling their legs in the air, hoping to get carried away by a wind current, and they balloon. They lay it out a small strand of webbing and get carried in wind currents to the next plant. That's how they disperse. So when they kill a plant, basically they go into dispersal behavior, and that's what you're seeing here. How fast do they reproduce? Well, you can get up to 12 eggs per day per female, about 100 during her lifetime. They can, at 81 constant temperature, 81 degrees Fahrenheit constant temperature, they can go from egg to reproductive adult in 7 days. And at cooler temperatures, it takes longer, but they I think the lower threshold for spider mites is somewhere between 50 and 55 degrees Fahrenheit. Below that, you won't get them developing, but they still can keep going at pretty cool temperatures. And last of all, they don't need to mate to reproduce. An unfertilized female will lay male eggs, but very quickly they will become reproductive males and mate with the female, and then she's now going to be able to produce females. How do they spread? We said before, they can spread on the wind. They can blow in from a field outdoors into a high tunnel. Plant movement, they can come in on plants. And if you're in a greenhouse, moving plants from one place to another by respacing the crop or whatever in pots, then they certainly, you can spread them that way. And then clothing, on your clothing. They can be moved around, as we said before, on clothing, workers' clothing. So Where should you look for spider mites? We'll certainly look for stippling on incoming transplants. You want to monitor the crop from start to finish by randomly looking at leaves to look for the first inkling of stippling caused by spider mites. And then at the end of the season, it's a good idea to be, if you've had a spider mite issue, and probably only if you've had a spider mite issue, but if you have, look for some overwintering mites, and I'll show you those in just a second. So in the upper right slide, you'll see early signs of spider mite infestation. Just light stippling on a tomato leaf, and that could mean bigger things very quickly. But that's sort of the first thing you're going to see, is just some light stippling on a tomato crop. And then down at the bottom of the eggplant, you can see a well-developed infestation. Very soon, that population could really explode and begin to web over the plant, and especially if it's hot and dry environmental conditions. Spider mites love it that way. So hot, dry conditions. This is some roses. A long time ago, I took this slide on some roses we were working on, just to show you how what the webbing can look like and what the leaves can look like when they're really fed out. All the chlorophyll has been removed. Where should you look for the spider mites? Well, again, incoming plant transplants, but also because they can be spread on clothing, you want to look at near doors of the plants, along walkways or near doors or places people will be coming in and out. Certainly along vents, the edges of the greenhouse near the vents where they could be coming in from the outdoors. Any hot, dry spot in the greenhouse can be important. And if you're growing hanging baskets, don't forget to look up there for spider mites, because they could be up there as well. This is what an overwintering two-spotted spider mite looks like. They do overwinter in the fall when the day length begins to decrease and the temperature begins to fall. It can trigger a population of spider mites to go into reproductive diapause. They're overwintering females. They're all females. They turn this orange color and they begin to seek out nooks and crannies in which to hide. It could be in the soil at the base of the plant. It could be in wood, a wooden bench. It could be various places in the greenhouse where they'll try and hide. But if you've been dealing with the spider mite population into the fall, you're going to be growing in that same greenhouse the following spring, if you've got overwintering spider mites, once the day length increases and the temperature increases, you may be seeing new spider mite infestations because you overwintered some spider mites. So you want to look for these guys in the fall if you've had problems with spider mites. As far as pesticides for spider mites, this is a list that I'm not going to go over in detail, other than to say that list that Betsy will put up from Dan Gilrain, that's the list to go to in New York State. And there's even more pesticides than this listed there, although this is a lot of them. I won't go over these, like I say, but these are some of the pesticides that can be used on edible greenhouse crops and taken from Dan Gilrain's list. Biological control for spider mites? Absolutely. Some of the most famous biocontrol examples were using Phytosylus persimilis, which I'll show you in a second, for spider mite on greenhouse cucumber. Spider mites are big problems on cucumbers, and some of the early work in biological control in the 40s and 50s were on spider mites on greenhouse cucumbers. But there's a lot of natural enemies that can be purchased. That's what this slide is showing, and just a partial list of some of the natural enemies that you can buy and used in greenhouses. And some of these are natural enemies or biocontrol agents for spider mites. So here's the most famous one. This is Phytosylus persimilis. It has this species name because it is orange. As you can see in the slides, even their eggs have an orange tint to them. As you can see in the lower left slide, you can see a very spherical, round, clear two-spotted spider mite egg, and then just below that is this pinkish cast to a chicken egg-shaped persimilis predatory mite egg. So these are predators.
John, you do have your cursor should work if you want to point anything out.
Oh, aha! Can you see that?
Yep. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so there is a persimilis egg. There is a two-spotted spider mite egg, and this is actually a persimilis adult female. And if you could look carefully, she's actually eating an egg right there. She's got that in her jaws, and she's eating it. And this is what an adult female a two-spotted spider mite looks like. And they're as large as she is, and so they're not the stage that gets attacked a lot. But the predator eats spider mite eggs like popcorn. They're defenseless. They can't run away. They're just sitting there, and she just goes from egg to egg and eats them. She'll also take on some of the young nymphal stages of spider mites. And these guys are voracious predators. They're very good searchers. They're fast runners. You can buy them and release them on your tomato or cucumber crop. And now the problem with persimilis is that in some cases they can be so good at controlling a small spider mite population that they basically go extinct. They eat all of the spider mites. There's nothing for them to eat, so they're gone. Now this is another mite called Neosulis californicus. It does not take out spider mites as fast as persimilis does, but it does attack them very well, and it'll persist at lower prey densities. It can hang out and show up at the first signs of spider mite infestations, just because it doesn't require, it's not as voracious. It does a good job, and some people will start with californicus and then add persimilis if they see a problem developing. And this is a grower sprinkling spider mite predators, persimilis, on some ivy in a greenhouse. The mite predators usually come in a bottle and are mixed in with vermiculite or bran or some kind of a carrier that you then sprinkle over the crop, and that releases the mites into the crop, and away they go. Now, so you do get help from natural enemies that come in from outdoors. And this is one of them that you might see in a spider mite infestation. This is Feltiella. It's a little maggot. It's a fly. The adult doesn't do anything to the spider mites at all, except it lays its eggs in patches of spider mites. And here's one of the maggots that hatches. They're orange. They're tiny little guys, but they basically crawl in a spider mite infestation and kill. They actually kill more spider mites than they eat. And there's just a couple pictures of them in the lower right screen. And then also aureus, the minute pirate bug, it will not only eat thrips, we'll talk about in a second, but they'll also eat spider mites as well. They're a general predator. And in fact, they'll eat each other if they're too crowded. But they here they're eating spider mites, and so they'll also give you some help. They are native here in North America in the Northeast, and so even if you don't release them in your greenhouse, it's conceivable that they could come in naturally in the open sides of a high tunnel and give you some spider mite control help. Okay, so that's it for spider mites. Going on to thrips. Probably the most common thrips we see in greenhouses is the western flower thrips. These things feed by, they've got, again, piercing, sucking mouth parts, so to speak, and they pierce leaf cells similar to spider mites, and they suck the chlorophyll out of the leaf cells. And so you can see here in a faint red circles, some immature thrips, there, and down here. And you can see the patches where they've been feeding. One diagnostic feature of thrips feeding damage is all the black fecal specks that they leave behind. You'll see that as opposed to mechanical damage. You'll see these fecal specks that'll occur. Here's some more fresh, and some old damage, but some fresh damage too, again, with the black specks that you can sort of make out. But this is all the damage that can really add up and damage leaves due to thrips feeding damage. And thrips populations can get very high. So here's a close-up of a second instar thrips nymph, and it's feeding, again, you can see where they, it's been feeding on leaf cells and the black fecal specks it's left behind as it as it's feeding. They also, if you're growing transplants, if they get into the bud tissue, they like to be in protected areas. If they get into the bud tissue and feed in that really tight protected area, they'll damage the leaves when the leaves are very young. And then when the leaves grow out, you've got damage that looks like this. You get gnarled, deformed leaves because of the damage that occurred when the thrips were in the growing leaf buds. And that's another problem that thrips can cause. A third problem that they can cause is transmitting TOSPA viruses, either in patients' necrotic spot virus or, in the case of these tomatoes, tomato spotted wilt virus. The thrips can pick up the virus as it matures and then they transmit it as an adult. And they can disperse in a greenhouse or high tunnel and they can spread this disease around. And there's no cure for the virus. The life cycle of thrips, this can be important to understand. First of all, the egg stage here is the eggs are actually inserted into the plant tissue. When they're inserted inside the plant tissue, there's no pesticide that can get to them. There's no predator that can get to them. When they're in the egg stage, they're in the plant tissue, and there's really nothing you can do about them until they hatch. So they hatch into first instar larva, which feeds for a while, goes to a second instar larva, it feeds for a while, and at the end of the second instar, they drop to the soil to pupate. They don't pupate on the leaves, they go down to the soil. And there's actually kind of, thrips are kind of weird. They have two pupal stages, a pre-pupa, and then an actual true pupal stage. And then after they're done in the soil, they emerge as adults and fly around to lay eggs and mate and all of that. Thrips can develop at cool, very cool temperatures as well as warm temperatures. They do top out at probably around 90, 95 degrees. Their development slows down a little bit. But if we look at total egg to egg, the number of days from egg to egg it takes for them to develop at a constant 59 degrees, it's 44 days, so it's pretty slow at cool temperatures, but it starts to go faster at warmer temperatures, and it's only 2 weeks at a constant 86. But the point is they can develop at cool temperatures, just takes a lot longer. Another important things about these flower thrips, the reason they're called flower thrips is they like to be in flowers. They don't only hang out in flowers, but they like that. And when they're in the flower, the females like it because they get to eat pollen. And pollen increases the reproduction of a thrips fivefold. If they have pollen in their diet, suddenly they can lay five times as many eggs as a thrips that doesn't have pollen in its diet. This is some work that a former PhD student of mine did just to document how what the reproductive difference is when pollen is available to the thrips compared with when pollen is not available. So when flowers occur in the greenhouse with pollen, that can really cause your populations to take off. You can use yellow sticky traps. That's the color I prefer. You get slightly more thrips, maybe to blue sticky traps, but then you don't get the other pests in greenhouses that are attracted. They're not attracted to yellow or to blue, but these other pests, fungus gnats, lyrimyza, leaf miners, white flies, winged aphids, all those come to yellow. And so with yellow, you can monitor lots of different greenhouse pests. So here's just a bunch of thrips that are caught on a yellow sticky trap. Some thrips tips. They have a very wide host range, including weeds. So weed control is just as important as controlling the pests on the crop. Overwintering is a possibility for thrips. If you, in the season the year before with a lot of thrips, there's a chance that you might start the next spring's crop out with thrips if they can hang out in a high tunnel. It can be protected enough that they can handle the cold temperatures. So again, thrips control starts at the end of the previous season. You want to clean up all sources of thrips, get rid of all the damaged plant material when you clean up the greenhouse with the high tunnel for the next year. They can come in on transplants and cuttings. You want to monitor throughout the crop with sticky traps. And in fact, before the crop goes in the greenhouse, you can put sticky traps in an empty greenhouse or empty high tunnel to see if there are thrips flying around already before you bring the crop in. Check for foliage for signs of damage, which I've shown you. Don't forget about hanging baskets, that there can be thrips up there. To minimize problems with pollen, if you don't need flowers on a crop, it sounds pretty weird, especially if you're growing a flower crop. But if there's times when you don't need flowers, if you pinch the keep the flowers pinched off, it'll actually help you control thrips because pollen will not be available to them. For spray applications, if you're spraying, you want small particle size because the thrips really get in protected tight places and you need small particle size to penetrate the tiny places where thrips will hide. And certainly biocontrol is an option. Again, these are pesticides taken from Dan Gilrain's list, so I won't go through these, but there are a number of pesticides available that you can use, some OMRI listed, some not, for greenhouse, for thrips on vegetables. Biocontrol, a number of natural enemies are available for thrips, and I'll go through some of these right now. There's a couple ways that these natural enemies can be used in greenhouses. One of them is what we call these slow-release bags or sachets. And the way this operates is that in these little paper bags, it's special paper, but anyway, inside the bag is bran, and feeding on the bran, actually feeding on fungus that grows on the bran, are some mites that are not pests of the crop. They only feed on the fungus on the bran, and we'll just, for sake of simplicity, call the grain mites. And then feeding on those grain mites can be the predatory mite. In this case, it's Neocelis cucumeris. There's another one called Neocelis swirskii, that is another one that you can get. Anyway, and these are these reproduce on the grain mites inside these bags, and there are little tiny holes in the bags that the mites can come out of. They reproduce in the bags, and then if you put the bags in the crop, then the mites will disperse from there and go out to hunt down thrips to eat. So here's some mini bags. The ones in the previous slide were a bit larger. These are mini bags, same thing, bran mites, and then predatory mites feeding on these. And these now you can put in individual pots or sprinkle through the crop. Also, another option, and I can picture this in a row of tomatoes or a row of some kind of crop growing in a high tunnel. These are ribbons. It's those same bags, except they're all lined up in a ribbon. And I think it's about every fourth bag actually has bran in it. The rest are just to help keep it in a ribbon form. But these can be stretched out through the crop. And these bags will issue predatory mites, if the conditions are good, for 4 to 6 weeks. So one bag will continue to produce these predatory mites for 4 to 6 weeks. And so you could stretch this through a crop and provide predatory mites for thrips control for 4 to 6 weeks using these ribbons. You also can blow these things onto the crop. You can make your own homemade blower with a modified leaf blower, and I can give you information how to do that. I think there's guidelines, and if you Google it online, on how to make your own blower. But another way that you can get these mites is formulated in bran or vermiculite. You can put them in one of these blowers and then just blow them out onto the crop. You need to do this weekly because the mites that you throw out into the crop, unless there's pollen for them to eat out there, and there usually isn't, they aren't going to establish. You would need to reapply these weekly in order to keep lots of predatory mites out in the crop. There's nematodes now that can be bought, and these are insect-killing nematodes. Remember, the thrips life stage in the soil that's the target for these nematodes. You can apply them to the foliage, but they'll wash off if with enough water. They wash off into the soil, and it's actually this, if you can actually target the soil but with a drench of these nematodes, then that'll really deliver the nematode to kill any thrips that are pupating in the greenhouse. And so, and these nematodes will not only kill thrips in the soil, the thrips pupae that are pupating in the soil, but also fungus gnats, shore flies, other kinds of soil-dwelling pests. They can work for those as well. You can apply them with common spray equipment. They do require water film for movement. The nematodes basically swim on a water film to hunt and kill their prey. If the soil is dry, they can't move. And so you need to have moisture at the time that you apply these nematodes in order to for them to search out and kill fungus gnat larvae and thrips pupae. Hypoastis miles is another very commonly occurring soil-dwelling predator that you can purchase. These probably do only need to be released once because they establish very well. And here's a picture of someone applying Hypoastis, also called Stradiolalaps, into some potted tomatoes in this case. And these are general soil-dwelling predators. They'll kill thrips pupae, they'll kill fungus gnat eggs, they'll kill other soil-dwelling arthropods. And because they eat lots of different things, that's why they can hang around and you don't need to reapply them. Aureus acidiosus is the last one I'll talk about. And oh my gosh, I'm looking at the time. Betsy, how much time do I have?
Betsy? You have until one, but you can keep going.
Okay.
Stop leaving, but that's one of the reasons we take these.
Yeah, okay, I'm going to go fast. So Aureus, you can see in the little red dot on the right there, a little bug, it's got a little tiny proboscis that's it's impaled a thrips, and that's how they feed. These are little tiny black and white predatory bugs. They're voracious predators. They eat lots of things, not just thrips. I showed you the spider mite it was eating before. They love to be in flowers. They do eat pollen. That helps them reproduce. But because thrips like to be in pollen and the aureus likes to be in pollen, it's a lovely thing that to get them established in your crop. They do have a winter diapause. In the fall, they will begin to go in diapause. They become less hungry, and they don't reproduce during the winter. You can use banker plants. I'm going to skip over that now. If you want more information on using banker plants to establish a crop, if you will, of these aureus, I can give you more information on that. So I'm going to skip these slides of using banker plants. Alyssum or ornamental pepper for banker plants to get aureus established.
Aphids. Don't put them in the box.
Yeah, okay. Aphids are another common pest in greenhouses, and I really recommend you read Judson's article. It's in the box folder. It's called IPM for Greenhouse High Tunnel Production, and I think the title box has it listed under his winter high tunnel aphid management. If the actual document says aphid management in winter tunnel greens, but it is excellent. It is really excellent for aphid management. Yes, it's on tunnel greens, but lots of good information, practical information gleaned by Judson over 4 years of management of aphids in high tunnels. So it's really, I really encourage you to read that. Fox glove aphid damage to pepper. Fox glove aphids is one of the aphid pests that we have, and they'll inject a toxin into, in this case, peppers, which really causes this leaf distortion. Most other aphids don't do this. They simply suck plant sap out of the leaves, but fox glove aphid will actually deform the leaves like this, and the leaves don't grow out of that. Aphids produce honeydew like whiteflies do, which is a sticky, sugary solution. You can see it in this slide. And they also, as they molt, which they do a lot, leave behind white cast skins like you can see over here on this leaf and this leaf. There's some more. And this black sooty mold can grow on the honeydew produced by the aphids. Aphids can be winged. Oftentimes, the one in the fall or in the spring, you may get a flight of aphids from outdoors that can enter a high tunnel. But in the greenhouse, usually we don't have the winged form of aphids. Usually we have non-winged forms. But in the spring, in the fall, and when you, if you have really high populations, you may get winged forms generating. And you can use yellow sticky traps to monitor the onset of these flights of aphids in a greenhouse. They will become attracted to yellow and stuck on a sticky trap, but that's not the best way to monitor for aphids, because most of the aphids look like this in the greenhouse. They don't have wings and they don't fly, so you can't pick them up on sticky traps. You have to actually turn leaves over and look for them, look for the sign of the honeydew they produce, look for cast skins that they can produce. And if you see ants walking around on plants in high tunnels, there's a really good chance that they're after the honeydew that is being produced by either whiteflies or aphids. So ants also can clue you in on the presence of aphids, even if you don't see the aphids themselves. Aphids don't need to reproduce or don't need to mate to reproduce. They bypass the egg stage, and adult female aphids give birth to living young. They don't lay eggs. And when those eggs or when those nymphs are born, they are born pregnant. So basically what you're looking at, the big aphid in the screen is a grandmother right now, because the baby she just laid is pregnant with her grandchildren. So they can really reproduce extremely fast because they don't need to mate, they don't wait for an egg stage. And they can develop from that newly laid nymph to an adult in 5 to 12 days. And another thing about them is that they can be very serious cool weather pests. And because they can survive very cold temperatures, they may be able to overwinter in a greenhouse. So here's some work that we've done looking at green peach aphid versus foxglove aphid. And this is at a constant 58 degrees, fairly cool. And you can see they, even at that cool temperature, it only took them 11 to 12 days to reproduce. or green peach aphid continues to take very little time, actually shortens the time at warm temperatures, whereas foxglove aphid can't handle its warm temperature, and it begins to slow down again at warm temperatures, and actually they can't survive a constant temperature of about 90 to 92 degrees Fahrenheit. They can't survive that, whereas green peach aphid can. Common aphid pests: green peach, melon aphid, foxglove aphid, potato aphid. If you're growing cucurbits in crucifers in a greenhouse, you'll probably have cabbage aphids and some more specialized aphids, but these are the most common aphid pests. Here's the list of pesticides available. Again, look at Dan Gilrain's pesticide list. For biological control, in early season, when it's cool, you probably will need to introduce beneficials during that time. Some of the parasitoids that I'll show you in a second work okay at cool temperatures. Judson reported that ladybugs that he put in row cover, under row cover, did a real good job for him on aphids. I can't remember what the crop was, even at cool temperatures. At warmer times, not only can you release natural enemies that you purchase or use banker plants for, but the other thing is you may get natural enemies coming in from outdoors. Hoverflies can come in, and aureus, other kinds of natural enemies can come in from outdoors. So here's a whole bunch of natural enemies that you either could purchase or could come in from outdoors and give biological control help for aphids in high tunnels or greenhouses. Greenhouse whitefly, last pest I'll talk about. This is the most common greenhouse pest, would be outdoors and to some extent in greenhouses. The other possibility is the sweet potato or silverleaf whitefly. However, unless you're growing actual greenhouse production, I don't think you're going to see, we don't have those established outdoors in New York State, although greenhouse whitefly is an outdoor pest and can definitely show up on tomatoes or other high tunnel crops, especially herbs. Rosemary and other kinds of herbs will have serious whitefly problems. This is the life cycle. Basically, the adult is the stage that flies. They lay eggs, which don't move. The eggs hatch into a little crawler. is only in the crawler stage for a couple of days. They find a place they'd like, put their mouth parts in the leaf, and they don't move again until they go through the rest of their molts and finally become an adult again. So they're sessile during this period of time. Pesticides registered for them, again, from Dan's list. And this is the most common parasitoid that you would probably use, or natural enemy that you would use for white flies. And this is Encarsia formosa, commercially available. It can be found outdoors, but it's much more common to use it. It won't be found in the numbers that you need. And so you would need, for biology control, to use these, to release these in the greenhouse. When greenhouse whitefly is parasitized by Encarsia formosa, the pupal stage turns black, as you see here, compared to unparasitized one on the right, that's the normal color of an immature whitefly. They come glued to little cards that you can rip apart and then hang them in the canopy of the crop so that when the adults emerge from these parasitized whitefly pupae, the adult parasite comes out, the little wasp comes out, and they fly around to look for whiteflies to parasitize. You hang these cards in the plant canopy. Another natural enemy that could be used in greenhouse high tunnels and such is this little predatory bug called Dicyphus. And Dicyphus can be encouraged with one release with mullein plants, the common weed found in ditches or whatever. They reproduce very well on mullein plants. And you can put these in your greenhouse to encourage the presence of these little predators, which are very good whitefly predators. And more and more we're seeing greenhouse tomato growers using Dicyphus on mullein plants in their greenhouse for whitefly control. And that's all I have. What time is it?
You have 3 minutes left. So if anyone has any questions, we have one that says, would chickens eat stink bugs?
You know, I did read something about, where was that?
There was a greenhouse thing that I sent out at my update that was talking about chickens in floriculture greenhouses being used for pest control.
Yeah, that's possible. If it's a low, I would say if it's a canopy height in the crop that's low enough for the chickens to get to, I think chickens are pretty, might be pretty equal opportunity predators. However, stink bugs do have an alarm chemical. When they're frightened, they have a chemical that might discourage chickens. I don't know. I don't know how picky chickens might be to stink bugs.
And with food crops, you want to make sure with fruit crops that you're following the best management practices as far as pathogens and the droppings from the chickens and those kind of
things. Oh, thanks, Brian. Yes. I don't think of that.
So we have another question that says, I'm curious as to how effective biological control has been in high tunnels with reference to their disbursement. How long would they stay in your tunnel?
If you give them something to eat, they'll stay. you're going to lose some. And you will lose more in a high tunnel than you will outdoors. But the reason I can say that is you would be amazed at when you stop spraying and when you have, especially if you have banker plants for various kinds of natural enemies that you may want in your greenhouse, you get all kinds of natural enemies coming into the greenhouse from outdoors. So yes, you may lose some if they can fly. The predatory mites that you put in for example, they're going to hang around because largely speaking, they're going to hang around. But the flying parasitoids, they may leave, but they also may be able to, those from the outside may come in. It's amazing how fast you can get natural enemies coming into the greenhouse from outdoors. And so if they're coming in from the outdoors, they're probably going both directions. But it really can be, a lot of people have had good success with biocontrol in high tunnels.
Great. Are there any other questions? If you want to unmute yourself and ask it directly, you can do that, or you can type it in. And it's 1 o'clock. Oh, here's a list. Is there a list of suppliers of biological controls? I've got a list that I could post, but thank you. That's a good thing to put in there.
That's an excellent thing to put in. Yes.
And this is Barb. Is there a list of banker plants that would be useful in high tunnels to attract natural populations of predators?
I'll put something together on banker plants. Either I'll find something because there's a whole bunch of things now that we're learning about that could be used as banker plants. Let me look for resources and give those to Betsy to post in the box folder.
That would be great. Thank you.
Anything else from anyone? If not, thank you very much.